Hello guys, so today we are going to discuss some important questions from the topic stock exchanges. So these questions are important for your SEBI grade examination. So guys, if you like this video, do subscribe to our channel. Now moving on to the first question. SEBI's recent regulations for stock exchanges state that they need to have a minimum net worth of 100 crores and an annual trading of 1000 crore. So accordingly, many stock exchanges have been de-recognized and some will be de-recognized soon. Only 3 stock exchanges are permanent now. 2 of those are BSE and NSE, which is the third one. So basically, SEBI introduced some new norms for stock exchanges in 2018. So according to these regulations, a stock exchange is required to have a minimum net worth of 100 crore and an annual trading of 1000 crore. So basically, this was done to reduce the number of stock exchanges, because India had a lot of regional stock exchanges. So we had a lot of regional stock exchanges apart from BSE and NSE. BSE and NSE everybody knows, but India also had a lot of regional stock exchanges like Delhi Stock Exchange, Madras Stock Exchange, Pune Stock Exchange, Ahmedabad Stock Exchange. But these stock exchanges were in name only because they were having very less trading. So basically they were passive. So basically they were not working. So SEBI decided to de-recognize them. So de-recognization basically means taking back their license. So a lot of stock exchanges have been de-recognized. So now currently only 3 stock exchanges are permanent. So BSE, NSE and Calcutta Stock Exchange, right? So accordingly, the correct option is C, Calcutta Stock Exchange, because Ahmedabad Stock Exchange has been de-recognized, Madras Stock Exchange has been de-recognized, Pune Stock Exchange has been de-recognized. Also, Delhi Stock Exchange has also been de-recognized, and similarly, many other regional stock exchanges have been de-recognized by SEBI. So now, BSE, NSE and Calcutta Stock Exchange, these 3 are permanent. Now, moving on to the next question. Question 2. Few statements regarding the governing board of a stock exchange are given below. So before reading out the statements, so basically SEBI regulations, the regulations regarding stock exchange, they talk about the governing board of a stock exchange. So a governing board of a stock exchange basically comprises of 3 types of directors. So what are these 3? Shareholder directors, public interest directors, PID, public interest directors, and managing director, MD. So shareholder directors, basically they are appointed by shareholders only, but approval of the board is required. And public interest directors are nominated by the board only. So they are nominated by the board only. And the managing director, he is considered a part of shareholder director. So they are considered a part of shareholder director only, right? And then there is a chairperson. So the chairperson of the board. So chairperson is elected from the public interest directors. So from the public interest directors only, a chairperson is elected. So now let us read the statements. Statement first, the number of shareholder directors shall not be less than the number of public interest directors. So this statement is not right. Why? Because it is the other way around, which means the number of public interest directors, they cannot be less than the number of shareholder directors. So the number of public interest directors, it shall not be less than the number of shareholder directors. So it is the other way around. This statement is not correct. Statement 2, the managing director is considered part of shareholder directors. So this statement is right. I have just told you. So statement 2 is correct. And statement 3, the chairperson is elected by the governing board from amongst the shareholder directors. So this statement again is incorrect. Why? Because as I have just told you, chairperson is elected from amongst the public interest directors, not the shareholder directors. So chairperson is elected from amongst the public interest directors. So statement 3 is also incorrect. So the correct option is B, because only statement 2 is correct. Now next question. So this question is about margin trading. So what is margin trading basically? So let's read. So margin trading is a practice where investor or trader uses borrowed funds from a broker to buy or to short sell a financial asset. So what do you mean by short sell? So short selling means selling an asset which you do not own. So you are borrowing a security because you expect the price of the security to go down. So that is short selling, right? So basically margin trading is a practice where the investor borrows funds from the broker to buy or short sell a asset, financial asset. Also the financial asset forms the collateral for borrowed funds. So the financial asset you are buying will itself become the collateral. Now, which of the following statements is not correct regarding margin trading? So you are given a few statements. So basically, a broker provides the facility of margin trading to the client. So broker provides the facility of margin trading to the client. Also, the client needs to open a margin account with the broker. So there are some regulations on the broker. So how much exposure a broker can take or how much debt a broker can take. So regulations have been specified for broker. So let us read the statements. Only corporate stock brokers with minimum net worth of rupees 3 crore are eligible to offer margin trading facility. So this statement is correct. Why? Because only corporate stock brokers are allowed to offer margin trading, and also only those corporate brokers who have minimum net worth of rupees 3 crore. So minimum net worth requirement is rupees 3 crore to offer margin trading. Next, statement B, it says total indebtedness of a stock broker cannot exceed 5 times of its net worth. So this statement is also correct. So I will explain you with the help of an example. So let's suppose a corporate stock broker has a net worth of 5 crore. So his total debt cannot exceed 5 times. So his total debt cannot exceed rupees 25 crore, right? So statement B is also correct. Statement C, margin trading was started by SEBI to curb speculative dealing in securities. So this statement is also right. Why? Because margin trading was started by SEBI in order to reduce the speculative trading. So before margin trading, the investor used to take a lot of gambles. So they would borrow money and invest in the securities based on the speculations. But they were not required to invest their own capital. But through margin trading, now the investors are required to invest their own capital also. So which is called margin money. So now they have their own stake. So when their own money is invested, so they will be more careful. And next, statement D, exposure to any single client cannot exceed 5% of the broker's maximum allowable exposure. So there is a limit to which a broker can take exposure. So the maximum limit for exposure for a broker is borrowed funds plus 50% of his net worth. 50% of net worth. So this is the maximum allowable exposure. But a broker can have less exposure. So to give you an example, let's suppose the net worth of a broker is 10 crore and he has borrowed 20 crore. So what is the maximum exposure a broker can take? So basically 20, the borrowed funds, plus 50% of net worth. So 50% of 10 crore, which is 5. So the maximum exposure allowed will be 25 crore, right? So this is the total exposure. And the exposure to a single client, it cannot exceed 10%, not 5, it is 10%. So exposure to a single client cannot exceed 10%. So in this case, exposure to a single client cannot exceed 2.5 crore. So statement D is incorrect. So the correct option is option D. Now moving on. Now before discussing this question, I would like to tell you that I have also discussed this topic on our Telegram group. So we regularly conduct quizzes and post questions on our Telegram group and also share a lot of relevant information for our exams. So do join our Telegram group. The link for the group is mentioned in the description below. Now next, question 4, demutualization refers to segregation of ownership and management of the stock exchange from the trading rights of the members. SEBI issued scheme of demutualization of BSE and other regional stock exchanges in 2003. So basically what is demutualization? So you are segregating the ownership and management from the trading rights. So before this demutualization happened, earlier the broker had a monopoly over the stock exchange. So the brokers only owned, managed, and they only had the trading rights. So there was a monopoly of brokers. So demutualization scheme was introduced in 2003 to break this monopoly and to bring efficiency in the stock exchange. So to bring efficiency in the working of stock exchange and to bring transparency, this scheme of demutualization was introduced, right? So according to the scheme of demutualization, so there were some recommendations. So basically a committee was formed under M.H. Kania. M.H. Kania is the former Chief Justice of India. So a committee was formed under M.H. Kania to look into the matter of demutualization. And also the scheme of 2003, so the SEBI introduced the scheme of demutualization. So according to the scheme, the board of a stock exchange should consist of 75% of public interest directors or shareholder directors, PID, SD, public interest directors or shareholder directors, and the rest 25% can be broker directors, right? So this was one. And second, the scheme said that 51% of the shares should be divested to the public, or should be sold to the public, and the rest 49% shareholding can remain with the brokers. These were the two important points which the scheme stated, right? So now let us read the statements. Statement 1, as per 2003 scheme, the board of a stock exchange should consist of 51% public interest or shareholder directors and only 49% broker directors. So this statement is not right. Why? Because the scheme says 75% of public interest or shareholder directors and only 25% of broker directors. So here the percentage is wrong. So statement 1 is incorrect. Now statement 2, as per the scheme, 51% of the shareholding of the stock exchange should be divested to public other than trading members, trading member brokers, and only 49% can remain with the brokers. So this is right, as I have just told you. So statement 2 is correct. And statement 3, a committee under Justice M.H. Kania was constituted to look into the matter of corporatization and demutualization of stock exchange. So this statement is right. So demutualization I have already told you, and corporatization is also similar. So basically earlier stock exchanges operated like a mutual organizations. So they were earlier like a mutual organizations. So after the scheme of corporatization and demutualization, now every stock exchange needs to be registered as a company, right? So the legal form has been changed from mutual to company. So statement 3 is right. So you, as you can see, only statement 1 is incorrect and statement 2 and 3 are correct. So option C is right. Statement 2 and 3 are correct. Now moving on, question 5. So again, this question is related to the directors of a stock exchange. So I have already told you there are three types of directors, basically shareholder directors, public interest directors and managing director. And managing director is considered part of shareholder director only, right? Now for public interest directors, they are appointed or nominated for a term of 3 years, which can be extended by another term of 3 years. And managing directors are appointed for a term of 5 years, and their term can also be extended for another term of 5 years. And the maximum age limit for public interest director is 75 years and for managing director it is 65 years, right? Now let us read the statements. Statement 1, public interest directors are nominated for a term of 5 years. So this statement is wrong. Why? Because they are appointed for a term of 3 years, which can be extended by another term of 3 years. So they are appointed for 3 years, not 5 years. Statement 2, maximum age limit for public interest directors is 65 years. So this statement is again wrong. Why? Because the maximum age limit is 75 years for public interest directors, not 65. 65 is for managing director, right? So statement 2 is also incorrect. And statement 3, a public interest director cannot become shareholder director unless there is a cooling off period of 3 years after ceasing to be a public interest director. So this statement is right. So what does this mean? So a public interest director can become a shareholder director, but there must be a 3 year gap. So let's suppose a public interest director, Mr. X, he resigns the office as public interest director in, let's suppose, January 2014. So he cannot become a shareholder director before January 2017. So there needs to be a 3 year gap or 3 year cooling period, right? So statement 3 is right. So accordingly, the correct option is A. Only statement 3 is correct. Now this is the last question. So this question needs to be solved by you. I will not tell you the answer now. So you need to write your answer in the comment section below, and then I will post the answer to this question later. So let's read the question. National Stock Exchange NSE was established in the year 1992. It was needed as there was inefficiency, lack of transparency in the existing stock exchanges. Also, the existing stock exchanges operated as mutual organizations, which led to conflict of interest between brokers and investors. So, a committee was formed which recommended establishment of NSE. So, who was the chairman of that committee? So, it is a factual question. So, write your answers in the comment section below. So, your options are M.H. Kania, M.J. Ferwani, Kumar Mangalam Birla and Uday Kotak. So, you need to answer the chairman of the committee. So, guys, if you have learned anything new from this video, so make sure you hit the subscribe button to get more updates and notifications. Have a good day.